Hi, and welcome to the Excel to Power BI series. I'm Dave from Automation and Answers. Over the next four episodes, we'll cover pivot tables, Power Pivot, Power Query, and finally Power BI. This will be your one-stop shop to not only learn about these important topics, but understand how they work together and build on each other to analyze data. By the end, you'll be able to use these confidently in your everyday work, and maybe, just maybe, you'll impress a few colleagues. So let's get started. You know, it's sad, but I delayed learning pivot tables for years because I could never understand those quadrants. And it got to the point where I thought, maybe I'll just learn something simpler, like brain surgery. However, eventually I did, and here are the five steps that I used to build my pivot table. Insert pivot table, set up quadrants, pick design options, pick analyze options, and add new data. So let's take these steps and start building our pivot table. The link to our example file is in the description. Here we have raw sales data from our fictitious company, Dave's Sports Warehouse. We sell wholesale sporting goods to local retailers. Our data includes invoice ID, invoice date, customer name, product sold, invoice amount, and delivery driver. Now what we want to know is, what are the annual sales to each customer broken down by product? Now you may be thinking to yourself, can't I do this analysis with Excel formulas and functions? And the answer is that technically, you could build a primitive version of something resembling a pivot table. However, as soon as you add new customers, products, and years of data, or you want to change the focus of your analysis, you'll quickly find yourself in a nightmare of perpetual manual changes, all of which would be avoided with a pivot table. With that said, let's start the pivot table building process. The first thing we want to do is to format this data as a table. Not a pivot table, but a table. And while this is optional, it is best practice because it makes your data area dynamic, which means that when we add new data, which we'll do in step number 5, it'll automatically be recognized as part of the sales table. To format as table, click anywhere inside the data, go to the Home tab, and select Format as Table. We'll select the style we want, and make sure that the checkbox My Table has Headers is checked, and click OK. And now, we have a table. Next, let's give our table a name. Click inside the table so that the Table Design tab appears. Click on it, and go to Table Name, and change it to Sales. Finally, let's insert our pivot table. Click anywhere inside the sales table, go to the Insert tab, and select Pivot Table. Leave everything as is, and click OK. And now, we've inserted our pivot table in a new worksheet. Onto the quadrants. Let's go to the right side of the screen to the Field List pane. You'll see there are fields which were generated from the headers in our sales table. And below those, you'll see four quadrants. These quadrants are the main reason why most people, including me for years, give up on pivot tables. Simply put, they're not intuitive at all. To build a pivot table, you need to allocate the necessary fields to their corresponding quadrant. Filters are the items by which you want to filter your pivot table. Columns are the column headers, rows are the row headers, and values are the values you want to summarize. In our case, how much we're selling. Let me share with you a little discovery that really helped me out. The quadrants are in the same location as they appear on the actual pivot table. So the filters are in the top left, columns top right, rows bottom left, and values bottom right. This is especially helpful to understand the difference between the columns and rows quadrants. Okay, let's begin the setup. To make it easier, we'll drag our field list pane closer to our pivot table and resize it. If you ever close this pane by accident, simply right-click on the pivot table and select Show Field List. As mentioned in the previous section, We want to build a pivot table that gives us the annual sales for each customer broken down by product. So in the rows quadrant, we'll drag and drop the customer field, and below it, we'll do the same with the product field. And as you can see, it gives us the customers broken down by product. The breakdown is in the same order in which the fields appear in the quadrant. If we flip them, the product becomes the primary category. Next, we want to break down by year. So we'll add invoice date to the columns quadrant. As you can see, many other date components appear, like years, quarters, and so on. We only want years, so we'll remove the others by dragging them out. And now the years are set up. Next, we want to know how much we sold. So we'll add invoice amount to values. By default, this provides the sum of the invoice amount. However, if we click on the down arrow and select value field settings, we can choose something other than sum, for example, count or average. In our case, we're happy with sum. While we're here, we'll change the number format displayed in the pivot table. We'll select number format, choose accounting, change decimals to zero, remove the dollar sign, and click OK. Click OK again, and the numbers are updated. However, what if we wanted to show the sales as a percentage of that particular year? We would go back into value field settings, go to the Show Value As tab, and select percentage of column total, and click OK. And now, we have sales as a percentage of that particular year. In our case, we don't want that, so we'll undo this change. Next, we want to filter our data by delivery driver, so we'll add delivery driver to the filters quadrant. And as we can see, the filter appears in the top left corner, and now we can filter data based on the delivery driver. Important note, you can also filter your data in the column labels and row labels by clicking on the drop-down menu and selecting your filter item. In this area, you can also select how you want to sort your data. All right, the quadrants are set up. As you can see, their location matches the pivot table. The filters are in the top left, columns top right, rows bottom left, and values bottom right. On to the design options. Another common issue with pivot tables is that by default, they look ugly. So let's see what we can do in the design options. First, click anywhere inside the pivot table, and the design tab will appear. Click on it. This entire step will focus on this tab. Next, we'll click on the More Designs icon and find a better design. Let's choose this one. We'll go all the way to the right, and here you can change your subtotals and grand totals. For example, if we want to remove the grand totals on the right, we'll select Grand Totals and select On for Columns Only. And now it's gone. Next, we have the option to separate customer and product fields into different columns. Go to Report Layout and select Show in Tabular Form. And now they're separated. In our case, this looks a little weird, so we'll stick with the compact form. Next, in the blank rows, we'll choose Insert Blank Line after each item, so that each customer's data is separated by a blank row. This makes it a little bit easier to read. And lastly, we can add or remove column headers and banded rows and columns if we wish. In our case, we'll stick with the default. Now our pivot table is starting to look much better, but what else can we do? On to the Analyze options. To view the Analyze options, click inside the pivot table, and the Pivot Table Analyze tab will appear. Click on it. This entire step will focus on this tab. First thing we'll do is add a slicer. Click on Insert Slicer and in the pop-up, select Delivery Driver, and click OK. And now, we can quickly filter the sales data based on the delivery driver. If we hold the Control key while clicking, we can select multiple drivers. Most people prefer slicers rather than filters because slicers show us the multiple items we've selected. In filters, we only see the text multiple items, so we have to remember which items we've selected, which is not very practical. To clear the items we've selected in our slicer, all we need to do is to click on the Clear Filters icon. Now, let's go back to the Pivot Table Analyze tab and add a timeline, which is similar to slicers, but for dates. Click on Insert Timeline and select Invoice Date and click OK. We'll move this over here. And in the dropdown, we'll select Years. And now you can filter the data by year. Pretty easy, right? What if we wanted to add a column to our pivot table to calculate sales tax? Once again, let's go back to the Pivot Table Analyze tab. Select Fields, Items, and Sets, and select Calculated Field. For the field name, we'll use Sales Tax. In the formula, we'll remove the zero and double-click on invoice amount. Next, we'll multiply it by the sales tax rate. In our case, we'll use 10% and click OK. And now we have a calculated field for sales tax for every year. To remove it from the pivot table, go to the field list pane and simply drag it out of the values quadrant. How can we visualize this data? Let's add a pivot chart. We'll go back to our famous Pivot Table Analyze tab and select Pivot Chart. Then select Line Chart and click OK. And there it is, blue for 2021, orange for 2022, and gray for 2023. Oh wow, 2023 isn't done and our sales are already ahead of last year. Great job, team. By the way, when you use your slicers or timeline, the pivot chart updates as well. Pretty cool, right? Now, let's add some final touches to our pivot table to make it a little bit more presentation friendly. One more time, we'll go back to our Pivot Table Analyze tab and click on Options. We'll go to the Layout and Format tab and uncheck Autofit Column Width on Update. This will keep the pivot table's column sizes as is when we refresh our pivot table. Otherwise, we'll have to manually resize them every time. Next, under the Display tab, we'll uncheck Show Expand Collapse Buttons to remove the plus minus symbols, which collapses and expands the subcategories. Lastly, we'll also uncheck Display Field Caption and Filter Dropdown to remove row labels and column labels along with their dropdown menus. Click OK. Now that the changes are applied, we'll do a few other things. We'll hide the top row by selecting it, right-clicking, and choosing Hide. We'll center the headers by selecting them, right-clicking, and selecting the center icon. And lastly, we'll do a quick resize of the columns. And you know what? I think we've achieved a decent looking pivot table. By the way, if you've enjoyed this video so far, please consider subscribing and clicking the like button. A sincere thank you. Now, time to add new data. The remainder of our 2023 sales data is found in the new sales data sheet. Let's navigate to it and copy the data. Then let's go back to our sales table, navigate to the bottom, and paste it. Because we formatted it as a table earlier, This automatically adds the rows to the sales table. Now, let's go back to our pivot table, right-click on it, and select Refresh. And as you can see, the 2023 sales data has been updated. Looks like everyone's getting a bonus. And that's it for our pivot table. Quick recap. We inserted our pivot table from the Insert tab. We set up our quadrants in the Field List pane. We picked our design options in the Design tab. We picked our Analyze options in the Pivot Table Analyze tab. And we added our new data and refreshed our pivot table. In our next episode, we'll cover Power Pivot, which takes your pivot tables to the next level. I hope to see you there, and best of luck on your automation journey.